All right, first of all, we open up the Julia package and go into the package mode by hitting the right square bracket. And I type ST to check out the status of my environment. I see that there's no package installed, so I type add Ferrite to add the Ferrite package to my Julia environment. You have to wait a couple of minutes depending on your computer speed, and that's something unavoidable. You have to wait for the packages and dependencies to be installed. After the Ferrite package has been installed successfully, we can go into the repo and type using Ferrite to make sure that the Ferrite is imported in our Julia repo successfully. So the next step is to add another package named FerriteViz, which is used for visualization purposes, and it integrates well enough with the Ferrite package for visualizing wireframes, meshes, and the domain of the partial differential equations that we want to approximate the solution of. Note that at the time of recording this video, the Ferrite package has released its version 1, which comes with breaking changes, and the FerriteViz package is not yet updated to integrate well with the Ferrite version 1. In one part of the tutorial, I used the FerriteViz to visualize the meshes, and after that, I used the Ferrite version 1 to show you the latest and the most up-to-date Ferrite way of solving partial differential equations numerically. Since the FerriteViz package needs a backend, here I'm adding the CairoMakie to my Julia environment. You can check out my other tutorials on CairoMakie and the Makie package to learn more about visualizations in Julia programming language. Since the heat equation is the hello world equation of finite elements, because it's much more simpler than the other partial differential equations, here I'm going to show you how to solve this equation on a unit square with a uniform internal source, where U is the unknown temperature field and K is the heat conductivity. F is the heat source and omega is the domain. Now you'll consider the homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions such that Ux is equal to 0 on the boundary of the domain, which is partial omega. Also, we have the resulting weak form of the partial differential equation in which we find the solution U in the solution space, where V is a test function and U and T are suitable trial and test function spaces. Now that we know everything about our problem, it's time to tackle the problem using the Ferrite package and numerically approximate the solution of the heat equation using finite element method. First of all, we import Ferrite and sparse arrays packages. First of all, we start by generating a simple grid with 10 by 10 quadrilateral elements using generate grid function. The generator defaults to the unit square, so we don't need to specify the corners of the domain. So, as the first argument, I pass the type of the element that I want the grid to have. Here, I pass the quadrilateral. This is the name of the actual type. And pass a tuple that shows the 10 by 10 quadrilateral elements. This is the number of elements that we will have in our grid. So now that we have the grid object, it's time to visualize it. We can do this with the FerriteViz package. So I type using FerriteViz and then use the FerriteViz.wireframe function and pass the grid object to it. But there is a problem with this code because we haven't yet specified the backend. So if I hit Shift Enter and run this line, I'll get an error that no backend is actually defined or imported. So for this, we have already added the CairoMakie package to our Julia environment. So I import the CairoMakie package by using the using keyword and calling the name of the package. You can check out my other videos, as I've already said, for the Makie package. It's a great package. So now we see the grid that we have already defined. It's a 10 by 10 quadrilateral elements type of grid defined on a unit square. We can also pass another type to the generate grid function to choose another element for our mesh. So I've passed the triangle type, which gives me a triangular element. If I pass hexahedron, you see that I get an error because hexahedron element is kind of a 3D type of element. So I have to pass a tree tuple. That is, depending on the dimension of our element, we have to pass the kind of discretization resolution. So here, if I, instead of 10 by 10, I pass something like 10 by 10 by 10 or 2 by 2 by 2 or 3 by 3 by 3, I can get another grid which is defined on a unit cube rather than on a unit square. So by specifying hexahedron, I've increase the dimension of my problem because I have chosen an element which discretizes a domain, a three-dimensional domain, okay? So now I just decrease the resolution of the discretization so it's more obvious for you what I mean. Since I wanted to solve this problem on a triangular mesh, I change the parameters I have passed to the generate grid function to get a triangular mesh on a unit square. Then the next step would be to dig a little bit more into the grid object. Imagine yourself being in a jungle, having no direction. It's like you don't have any kind of map and you want to understand the things gradually. I call the DOM function and pass the grid object to it. So it gives me some details about this object. This way I'm interrogating the object to understand it more. Here we have a grid object, and this object consists of several fields like cells, which is an array of type triangle, and it has 50 elements, triangle number 1, triangle number 2, triangle number 3, triangle number 4, and so on till triangle number 50. And this gives us some idea of what's going on. And we have another field named nodes, which gives the coordinate of those points or information about the nodes, actually. And we have other things like cell sets and node sets and face sets and edge sets. These are the things that the grid object consists of, vertex sets. And finally, the boundary matrix, which is a sparse matrix of type bool and int 64. So as you see, this grid object consists of several things, and it can give us useful information about the topology of our mesh and the coordinate points, the boundary matrix, which is a Boolean valued matrix. Now you can even interrogate the object further by using the IntelliSense, but the VS Code extension is useless enough to not be able to give you useful information. So we use the Julia REPL instead. We type grid, type dot, and hit the tab, and this tab gives us the field names like nodes, cell sets, and the other things that we have already discussed. For example, grid.cells gives us the cells, which is a 50-element vector of type triangle. And grid.boundary matrix gives us the boundary matrix, which is a sparse matrix. And grid.whatever field name that you want to call. And this way, we get further information, like grid.nodes gives us the coordinates of the nodes that we have. And this is a great thing. This is a great way to interrogate objects, to learn more about the functionality of a package that is not documented well enough. I'm not specifically addressing the ferrite, but talking in general. Now I'm going to talk about the cell values. A cell values facilitates the process of evaluating values and gradients of test and trial functions. To define this, we need to actually specify an interpolation space for the shape functions. Here I'm using the Lagrange functions based on the two-dimensional reference triangle. I also define a quadrature rule based on the same reference element. We can combine the interpolation and the quadrature rule to a cell values object. This is a way to wrap the objects for further usage of our finite element solver down the line. Same as the grid object, you can also dump the cell values variable to see what it holds, and it gives you useful information about the cell values variable. For example, it tells you that the cell values variable has some field like geomapping and lots of other field names that you can use. You can type cell values dot and hit tab and get the determinant of the Jacobian and function values, quadrature rules. And it gives you all these in the cell values object that is returned by the cell values function. The next step is the degrees of freedom. We need to define a DOF or degrees of freedom handler, which will take care of numbering and distribution of degrees of freedom for our approximated fields. We create the DOF handler and then add a single scalar field called U based on our interpolation that we have already defined, that is IP. Then we use the close exclamation to close the DOF handler. As a result, the DOFs or degrees of freedoms are distributed for all the elements. Now that we have distributed all our DOFs, we can create our tangent matrix using the allocate matrix function. This function returns a sparse matrix with correct entries stored in it. For the boundary conditions, in Ferrite, constraints like Dirichlet boundary conditions are handled by a constraint handler. So we get the constraint handler object, name it CH, and pass the DH to the constraint handler. For the problem that we have already discussed, we define the homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions on the whole boundary, that is, the union of all facet sets on the boundary. So we define the partial omega and pass to the union function and get the facets of our grid object, that is, left, right, top, and bottom. Now we define our Dirichlet constraint. We specify which field the condition is for and our combined facet set partial omega. The last argument is a function of the form fx or fx and t, where x is the spatial coordinate and t is the current time and returns the prescribed value. Since the boundary condition in this case does not depend on time, we define our function as fx equal to 0. That is, no matter what x we return, the value 0. When we have specified our constraint, we use the add exclamation mark to add it to the CH, that is, constraint handler. This way, we add the Dirichlet returned object to the constraint handler. Finally, we also need to use the close exclamation mark to close our constraint handler. When we call close exclamation mark, the degrees of freedom corresponding to our constraint are calculated and stored in our CH object. The next step would be to assemble the linear system. So we have all the pieces needed to assemble the linear system. K times U is equal to F. Assembling of the global system is done by looping over all the elements in order to compute the element contributions K sub index E and F sub index E, which are then assembled to the appropriate place in the global K and F. Basically, we have local element K and F, then we assemble these into a global K and F to solve the global linear system. Now we define the function assemble underline elements exclamation mark, which computes the contribution for an element. The function takes pre-allocated KE and FE. They are allocated once and then reused for all elements. So we first need to make sure that they are all zeros at the start of the function by using the fill exclamation mark. Then we loop over all the quadrature points, and for each point, I mean quadrature point, we loop over all the local shape functions. So we need the value and the gradient of the test function V and also the gradient of the trial function U. We get all of these from cell values. In the assemble underline element exclamation mark function, I have used the name delta U for the test functions. We define the function assemble underline global to loop over the elements and do the global assembly. The function takes our cell values, the sparse matrix K, and our DOF handler as input arguments and returns the assembled global stiffness matrix and the assembled global force vector. We start by allocating KE and FE and the global force vector F. We also create an assembler by using the start assemble function. The assembler lets us assemble into K and F efficiently. We then start the loop over all the elements. In each loop iteration, we reinitialize the cell values to update derivatives of shape functions and compute the element contribution with assemble underline elements exclamation mark that we have already defined. point and then assemble into the global KNF with assemble exclamation mark function. To obtain the solution, that is the final step, the last step is to actually solve the system, obviously, okay? First, we call the assemble underline global to obtain the global stiffness matrix K and force vector F. So it returns assemble underline global returns that K and F. And to account for boundary conditions, we use the apply exclamation mark function. This modifies the elements in the K and F respectively, such that we can get the correct solution vector by using the backslash. And as the final step, we have to export the solution in a format that we can visualize. Okay, so to visualize the result, we export the grid and our field U, which is the solution, to a VTK file so that we can use the softwares to visualize the VTK. Okay. After storing the solution as heat underline equation.vtk and visualizing the result, we see that it's pretty obvious that the solution of our heat equation is actually approximated on triangular meshes. In this example, I used the low resolution to show you exactly the interpolated values of the nodes inside each triangle, which is represented as a gradient of a color, depending on the values of the nodes. Guys, drop a comment and let me know what you think about the Ferrite finite element toolbox. It would be really useful to test several different kind of software packages that are famous for solving finite element methods to assess and evaluate them to test their effectiveness basically for different kind of problems and see which one shines in what area. And this is really cool to have reviews like this. And if you have any questions, feel free to drop a comment or your opinion about the finite element softwares available, packages, anything.